I want to know this person is talking to this sentence itself. And again, I put a lot of information in one condemned sentence to simplify things, but this would be feel over the long document. If you just look at simple Wikipedia statistics, it's uninformative because there are hundreds of socialist parties mentioned in Wikipedia, and the relevant one, which you probably figured out, is Serbian socialist party, is place 300, so what you consider it in our top 10. So the question is how to highlight this and how to make this decision. And if you didn't notice, you can take this sentence or this document and start Googling a little bit, and after a couple of searches, you'll figure it out. The question is, how can we automate this search if you want? And automating this search really boils down to understanding better the text. So for example, there is an opposition relation between Yugoslav president and Slobodan Milosevic. There is a correspondence relationship between Slobodan Milosevic. So in the possessive relationship between this Hitler and the socialist party, and all this together allows you to grow to some resources. So basically figure out that, yeah, there is a relation, or there is a mention in this guy's page of the Serbian socialist party, and then you know something that you didn't know on the text. And again, the technology that we're using in order to put these things together is similar to what we had before. We have this objective function where the left side encodes the statistics, the link statistics, and the various other statistics that we take from Wikipedia, and the right side really encodes the relation influence, whether the relation exists between, you know, two candidates, and this allows us to do this kind of global influence, and allows us to make more coherent decisions, which can influence the results. And again, the point I want to make is that having some knowledge and knowing how to use this knowledge allows us to acquire more knowledge and facilitate this knowledge acquisition process. And, you know, it improves the results very significantly. The key point I want to make is really that, you know, with this as a starting point, one of the things we're thinking about now is how to use this resource as a way to get more knowledge. Also, of course, how to represent it so that we can use it in a useful way. Okay, so my next few minutes, I'm going to talk a little bit about learning. And as I said, there's a lot to talk about learning. Everything that I talked about so far really underlines it. There are learning processes that I didn't talk about. So I want to talk about one learning paradigm that I think we should think about more, because it's essential for us to understand it and be able to use it. Clearly, understanding language requires supervision. So if I want some guy here to help me make this coffee, I need to be able to talk to this guy in a language they understand. So there has to be some translation into a formal language of some sort that this guy understands. How to translate my natural language to this formal language, so-called problem, is a difficult task that, if we think about it from the standard machine learning perspective, it requires undertaking text with meaningful presentation. The teacher really needs to understand what representation these agents understand and what doesn't. And if it's a problem that I think is not scalable. Instead, I want to be able to translate and to use the response-based learning approach. I want to be able to explore indirect signals in the interaction with this guy. For example, I want to be able to guess a representation that this guy may understand. And he's going to make a copy. And then I'm going to give feedback on the quality of the code. Did he understand my request or not? And the key question is, can we rely on this level of interaction, supervisor supervision? Can I propagate his response to a supervision signals to the translation process? So basically, I want to be able to recover meaning from the text without examples. So in a little bit more details, I want to be able to develop supervision for language understanding via this relatively simple interaction. So I'm going to give this example in the context of geoquery. So it's a geographical database where I'm starting with a sentence of the population density of this. And I want to be able some learner is going to convert this to a formal representation that is going to be translated to the database. There's an answer here. I have some problem with my color. Okay. Let's start again. There's going to be some model that is going to take this sentence, translate it to a formal language, that will be sent to the database and produce a number, the answer. So if you can think about this, the number of the database along with the representation is my environment, you can think about it. The database system, it could be a game API, it could be a physical device that you want to interact with. Now the standard machine learning approach really breaks the environment in two parts and provides supervision at the form of this representation to the model. Right? So we really need experts to validate this, and we need to know a lot about the representation that this environment knows and likes to get. I want to move from this type of protocol to a protocol which I call responsive learning, where the error goes directly from the answer to the model. I don't need to know what representation the environment uses inside. I want to be able to be agnostic to this representation, and this will allow me also to supervise this by people that can just check the facts. They don't really need to know formal logic of any sort or know anything about the representation. So this is the type of learning protocol I'd like to advocate. And specifically for this geoquery domain, given this sentence that is translated in the database domain into this smaller presentation, I'm going to again produce an answer. Again, if the traditional approach is to learn from logical form and text, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to only use the response. I'm going to look at the sentence in area and determine whether it's the right answer or the wrong answer. what the algorithm is doing, essentially, it guesses the semantic pulse. And then, if it gets a response at all, it means that something was right about the representation put here. Moreover, if the predicted response is the accepted response, which is easy to check, then I have a positive example. If it's true, then I have a negative example, and my learning protocol needs to think about it deliberately to adjust usage as a negative response. Or am I able to understand the negative, the reason for the negative response?
Why do I think of this code even opportunity? So here's why. Here's the kill.
which shows the number of different instances of given size for the power 3-second problem in gigawatts. And the blue curve shows the number of different solutions, different structures that you get for different size instances. And you can see that there's a big gap between the number of instances and the number of solutions. Similarly, if you look at the dependency passing, this is the number of, the red curve is the number of instances, the blue curve is the number of solutions. Moreover, if you look at the distribution, for a given size, you will see that it's very skewed, you know, very few solutions appear at all times. And most of the solutions appear very rarely, right? So, very, very few distribution, as you would expect if you ever looked at the data. So basically, these statistics show that there are many instances that collapse and produce identical input outcomes. So there's a pigeonhole principle here. The question is, can we actually exploit it? Can we somehow look at a lot of solutions and even a new problem, previously unseen problem, figure out, well, this is going to get the same solution of something that I've seen before. So in the next few minutes, I'm going to give you some conditions on the objective functions under which the solution of a new problem Q is the same as the solution of the previously observed problem P, even though the problems are different. So the setting, I will explain the experimental setting so you see what we're running. So basically, we test what I'm going to show on the standard test set that we're using. In this case, I'm going to show you mathematical learning over the problem of jointly influencing four entities and relations between them. Before we did this test, we ran our model on 250,000 instances, and we cached it. So we cached tail, objective and solution. Now, the important thing to observe here is that there's no training for this. I mean, once you have a model, you can run it on any data you want and generate as large a cache as you want. Once you have the cache, everything I'm going to say is going to apply. So here's an example of a theorem. So again, T is the problem I've seen before. T is the new problem. It's an IP problem. This is the solution that I already have for T. And this is the objective function for P and for Q. And the theorem says, or the first theorem says, if the objective coefficient of active variables, so that we assign 1 in the T solution, you will not decrease compared to Q, as you can see here, and the objective coefficient of the inactive variables did not increase, as you can see in this rule, then the optimal solution of Q is the same as of P. I don't need to send it even to the input engine. I can just read it on the cache. And all of this very simple theorem that you can spend 5 minutes thinking a little bit about it and prove give me nice speed up. So we measure the speed up as a ratio between the number of frequency calls without amortization over the number of frequency calls with amortization. And you can see that all of this theorem 1, the baseline is 1 here, and what we get here is a ratio of 2.4, 2.5, which means that only 40% of the problems I need to send to the input engine. The rest are just not the solution. Here's another example of a theorem. So think about the objective function as vectors in a vector space, CP1, CP2. If it so happens, and let's assume that P1 and P2 have the same solution, the same maximizer. In this case, all the conic combination, all the objective functions that are in the conic combination, that is linear combination, is positive weight between CP1 and CP2, are going to have the same maximizer. So for all these problems, I don't need to send them to the input engine. I can read all the solution from the cache. I'm going to give one other problem, one other theorem, it's a little bit harder to explain. So let's assume that I have these two competing structures, and the top one, the big one here, is the objective variable for problem P, and this is the second best component. So I'm looking at the margin between my solution for P and the next best solution, I call this delta. Here comes a new objective function, and let's assume that the first solution produces a slightly smaller objective value, I'm calling this gap A, a slightly larger solution for other, objective value for other solutions, the second best, for example, P and T. It's clearly the case that if A plus B is smaller than delta, then the solution I chose for P is still the optimal solution for P. So the blue one here is still going to be the optimal solution for P. What does this give me? Already for this theorem, I can get a ratio of about 3, which means I need to solve only 1 in 3 problems. Already, I'm quite excited, I think, because we work very hard in actually processing to get a little bit of saving in computation, and dealing 66% of the problem we just don't need to solve. I'm going to make one more step here. Again, going back to this graph, we notice the gap between the red curve and the blue curves. If you look at it a little bit more carefully, I mean, everything that I've done before relies on this redundancy of structures. If you look more carefully, you see that when the problems are small, on the left side of this curve, the gap is larger. So really, I want to deal with small problems or component problems. So the next step is to take these problems and decompose them, and then use the previous technology on these smaller components. And this is really what we've done. We basically use the redundancy of components, essentially, I showed you this problem before. The left side is the verb, the right side is the proposition. I have some joint constraint. I'm eliminating the joint constraint. I'm going to solve each one of the smaller problems by itself. And use the technology of appealing to the cache and hoping that I'm going to get good hits. And then I'm going to introduce the new constraint with one step of the Lagrangian realization. Similar thing with entities and relations. I have multiple relations. What I'm going to do is I'm going to eliminate some of the constraints, the joint constraint, for example, in this example here. Now I'm going to get two smaller problems. I'm going to solve each one of them, hoping for better, more cache hits. And indeed, what you can see is that once I'm including the composition, the margin, the best theorem that we have, the margin based by the composition, I need to go to the inference engine only once every 6 problems, which is quite nice. I mean, 85% of the cases, I don't need to even support the surface. So that's the bottom line, that's the basic that we have on semantic volatility. So before we started this process, we cached 250,000 solutions. Of course, this is going to be a function of the size of the cache. But what we try to do this is, you know, to show the possibility. It's not an industrial level implementation. This is actually my next slide. For closing advertisement, I have to say that, you know, this is, this is sort of very nice. There is some cost in going to the cache, and there is some cost in evaluating whether the theorem calls. And I think we actually know how to check the condition of the theorems quite well, but I must admit that our implementation of the cache isn't the best one. It's kind of the one-night world, basically. And you know, some people know how to do this better, and we pay some because of that. So if you measure the workload improvement, you don't get 85%. You still get quite nice results. So for example, with the decomposition, what we get is that we need to solve only 1 in 2.6 queries. It's not 1 in 6, as we have it with, you know, zero time access to the cache. 1 in 2.6, which is still quite nice. And I'm sure this can be improved with better implementation. And I just want to make a final note that you can actually, if you embed the sequence process inside the cluster position program, you can get even better improvement to this cluster inference. Okay, I'm done. I just want to conclude. And basically what I try to do is to give you some samples from a research program that attempts to address some of what I think are the key scientific and engineering, or some of the key scientific and engineering challenges between us and economic understanding. So I focus on knowledge, reasoning with knowledge, a little bit about learning paradigms and scaling up. There's a lot more things that we need to do, and some more things that we try to do, and I've listed a few of them here, and I'm happy to talk about this with people while I'm here. And I want to finish with a shameless plug for our tools, demos, programming language like Java, and so on. And thank you.
The main success, or the main
1976, that's for sure, was the first four car theory, which was proved in 1976 by Hagen and Appel at University of Illinois, Appel. The no problem since 1852, so that's actually was a series of problem. And it was essentially solved by very exhaustive proof by case analysis. In fact, they did about 2,000 special subbands, and then after identifying those maps, they used a program to verify that those maps could be colored properly. I was actually, and put it up here, that this program is about 90% human and 10% machine. Okay, the machine was critical to get it done, but the human intuition of how to go about the proof were really the main part. So I won't hide it. Actually, did part of it by hand, and then realized after a while, okay, we can just automate the switch on. Okay, so the electrical computer proof, the human aspect was very important. Okay, the proof is being accepted now in the mathematical community, it's being replicated. Still, I think in the mathematical community, there's sort of a sense of that it's an unsatisfying solution to this famous open problem. It's quite being elegant from that perspective. And the key problem is that, you know, the proof itself does not provide any further insight into why the problem is true, or why the theorem is true, okay? So that's just sort of the mistake there, and we haven't been able to find a better proof, okay? So as it goes to the robot, 20 years later, there was another reason.